Chapter 1, Episode 10 to 13. The Tapasya of Vedavyas and Boon Granted by Sri Shiva. The story of Raja Sudyumna being turned into a woman. Her stuti to the goddess and the goddess granting her a place at her lotus feet. The Rishi said, "Honorable Sudji, you have already mentioned that Vyasji was very competent and learned. He recited the entire Puranas to Sukadev. By what tapasya did he gain Sukadev as a son? In this connection, you were fortunate to hear the story from Vyasji himself. Please be kind and tell us exactly as you heard it." Sudji said, "Sukadev was a yogi of the highest order. How he took birth as the son of Satyavati Nandan Vyas is what I am going to narrate to you. Many ages ago, Vedavyas has a strong desire to have a son. And with this in his heart, he went to the area where holy men congregate on Mount Meru and started very austere penance. In his meditation, it occurred to him again and again that worship of the Devi is of paramount importance and absolutely necessary. He who does not worship the Devi is not worthy to exist in the world. The person who worships the Devi is exalted and worthy of respect. The place that Sri Vyasji selected for his penance had a most wondrous oleander grove with beautiful fragrant flowers of blackish red and yellow hues. Gods and ancient sages used to live in this grove. Also, present were Aditya, Vasu, Rudra, Marut, Ashwini Kumars and others who had attained Brahma Sakshatkar, God realization. Divine music floated over the place. Gradually, the brightness of Vedavyasji's radiance started spreading and it enveloped this earth. His locks began to glow like golden embers. Seeing this effulgence, Indra, god of the Devas, became perturbed. He went to Sri Shankar and entered into his presence. Sri Shankar observed, "O Indra, you are king of the Devas. How is it you are overcome with fear? What is it that disturbs you? You should never have any misgiving, intolerance or jealousy against tapasvis. Together with my Shakti, I am worthy of reverence, worship and adoration. With full knowledge of this, the Munis are always immersed in meditation and tapasya. They have no unfriendly or injurious intentions towards any living being." After hearing these words of Sri Shankar, Indra asked, "Why is Vyasji performing this ghor tapasya, that is, formidable penance? What are his intentions?" Sri Shankar replied, "Vedavyasa desires a son. That is why he is doing this difficult penance. He will soon complete 100 years of tapasya, then I will grant him a fine son." Sudji says, thus spoke Sri Shankar to Indra. Then Bhagwan Shankar went to Vyasji and said, "Vasavinandan Vyas, arise O sinless one. You are going to receive the gift of a son who will be sinless, guiltless, brilliant, possessing wisdom of the highest order, who will have the knowledge of the self, who will gain extensive fame and win laurels, whose conduct will be faultless, whose communication will be sweet and pleasing, virtuous, valiant, upright, prowess belonging to the highest order according to the Puranas. He will be endowed with sattvic qualities and he will also be very pious." Sudji says, after hearing these most auspicious words in the Madhurvani, sweet voice of Sri Shankar, Vyasji prostrated in obeisance and then proceeded to his ashram. After so many years of extreme penance, he was tired. Soon, he began to ponder, "In order to beget this son, there has to be a wife, and I do not have one. But how to acquire a wife? Because it can only mean getting shackled in chains. Whether a woman produces children or is chaste and observes moral rules, she is still a binding force. She will want all her desires and requirements to be fulfilled. A householder's life is full of problems. How am I to accept this situation?" While he was thus musing, an apsara called Gritachi assumed a divine form and appeared before him. Vyas ji saw her, but the thought came to him that if he accepted her, all the host of munis who were in different stages of tapas and meditation would make fun of him. However, marriage and household does give a lot of happiness. It is said that in the state of marriage, you receive the gift of children, you attain heaven, and once you get the knowledge of the self, you even get moksha. Long ago, he had heard Sri Narada's reasoning in this context. There was an apsara called Urvashi who enchanted King Pururava. In the end, she abandoned him. The munis requested Suji. There is a story of how Ila gave birth to Pururava. Please narrate that to us. Suji agreed. There was a king named Sudyumna. Never an untruth or false word came out of his mouth. He had full control of his senses and faculties of perception. One day, he mounted his horse and set out to hunt in the forest. He was accompanied by many ministers. He carried his splendid bow, ajgav, and a quiver full of arrows. While hunting, King Sudyumna strayed into a singularly beautiful part of the forest, which was at the foothills of the holy Mount Meru. The beauty was enhanced by the delicate and fragrant parijat and other climbing plants bearing flowers. Also, there were trees like bakul, fragrant flowers, tarkul, flowers used as ear ornaments, tamal, evergreen, champa, magnolia, mahua, edible sweet flowers, vasanti, jasmine, malati, flowering creeper, jackfruit, mango, neem, and fruits like banana, coconut, and pomegranate. There were ponds with water lily and birds like cranes and swan. Continuous musical sounds came from a bamboo grove. Bumblebees were droning on the fragrant air. This forest was verily an abode of joy and peace, and Raja Sudyumna felt very gratified. So also his attendants. Then of course, all of them entered into this wonderful forest. No sooner had they stepped in, all of them were turned into women. Even the horses they were riding turned into mares. They were greatly distressed and began to run hither and thither, trying to understand what strange transformation had befallen them. The king was most distressed and wondered who had played this trick and how he could ever return to rule his kingdom. The puzzled rishi said, "Suji, this is a most astonishing happening. King Sudyumna was such a righteous man and the forest was so pleasing and bounteous. What could have happened for this kind of retribution? Please tell us." Suji explained, "It was a long time ago that many rishis desired to have a darshan of Lord Shiva. When they entered, the Lord was in the company of Bhagavati Uma. On seeing the rishis, the goddess was filled with lajja, bashful modesty, and moved away from the Lord. Her entire being was trembling with shyness. Seeing this, the rishis realized that they had breached divine protocol and they rushed to Sri Narayan for refuge. Seeing his beloved Parvati blushing and diffident, Sri Shankar pacified her thus, 'Don't be upset. To please you, I declare that any male who enters these forests out of allurement and spiritual ignorance will immediately be changed into a female. This is the ban imposed on this forest by Bhagavan Sri Shankar, and since then it has become a storehouse for men with flaws, shortcomings, and weaknesses. Since then, no being who has knowledge of this has ever made the mistake of entering this most tempting and alluring forest. Unfortunately, Raja Sudyumna was unaware of this, and in ignorance, he and his followers entered and had to suffer the consequence.' Now the black clouds of despair engulfed the king. Being a woman, he could not return to his palace, and he and his followers began to wander here and there. His name was now changed to Ila. While still moving outside the forest, a young man by the name of Budh, son of Chandrama, met Ila. She was very beautiful and attended on by many women. Budh expressed his desire to make Ila his wife. Ila also wished to have him as a husband. They both married and Ila gave birth to Pururava, son of Budh. After this, Ila was again troubled by thoughts of the palace. So she visited the guru of their dynasty, Kulguru Acharya Muni Vashisht. He was a very benevolent and compassionate guru and was moved by Ila's plight. He immediately started prayers and invocations to Sri Shankar. He was pleased by the eulogies of sage Vasishth, but he did not reverse the ban. He, however, made a concession. Raja Sudyumna would be a man for 1 month and a woman for 1 month in the future. After receiving this boon, the king returned to the palace. During the month that he was a woman, he stayed confined within the palace. During the time that he was a man, he ruled as a king. But soon his subjects reacted and could not accept such a repulsive situation. As soon as possible, he installed his son Puru Rava on the throne and retired to the forest. He visited Muni Narad and learned from him the Navakshar mantra of 9 syllables. He was filled with devotion and started chanting this holy mantra. Then the great goddess who grants deliverance and salvation to all was pleased. She gave darshan to the king. She was seated on a lion and was bedecked with ornaments. Her form was most pleasing and awe-inspiring. During this visit, the king was in the form of the woman Ila, and her eyes bloomed with happiness. With unbounded joy, she folded her hands and bowed in worship and began to sing praises to the goddess Jagadamba. Ila said, "O goddess Bhagavati, I am most blessed and fortunate to have received a glimpse of your universal divine form. You are verily the supreme goddess who looks after and guides the visible and invisible gods. You are bedecked with different ornaments of jewels and diamonds. It is your nature to give prosperity and rewards of penances. You open the gates of moksha for your devotees. I prostrate before you, O Jagadamba. When even the gods have not been able to adequately describe your magnificence, how can we ordinary mortals even attempt to comprehend your majesty? It is only by your glance that the true meaning of the scriptures becomes clear. O Devi, I am spellbound by your grandeur. The gods Brahma, Vishnu and Mahesh, Indra, Varun, Surya, Chandrama, Agni, Pavan, Kuber and the Vasus have not been able to completely comprehend all your glory and nature. How can we, who are lacking in virtues, even try to know who and what you are? O Mother, Shri Vishnu is noble and splendid, but he also is unaware of yourself and allows his feet to be rubbed by your manifest form as his Shakti, Satvik Swarup Shri Lakshmi, who looks after the wealth and well-being of this world. Similarly, Brahmaji knows you only in the form of Rajas Swarup Shri Saraswati, who destroys ignorance, and Shiva knows you as Tamas Swarup Shri Parvati. In comparison, I am ignorant and lacking in knowledge, and this wondrous gift of a vision of your immeasurable glory is beyond my comprehension. Bhavani, I am slowly beginning to understand your compassionate demonstration. It is your nature to be moved by unbounded faith and ananya bhakti, where there is no other. It was only when you assumed the form of Lakshmi that Sri Vishnu succeeded in killing the demons Madhu and Kaitab. Then why does Sri Vishnu get his feet pressed by you? I understand. As you are radiant and effulgent like fire, he gets his feet purified by contact so that he can uphold the universe and preserve dharma. Even when sage Bhrigu kicked Sri Vishnu on the chest, he was so full of yearning for Sri Devi that he did not get angry, just as the Ashoka tree does not get angry with the gardener who trims it to make it look beautiful. All the gods pay obeisance to Sri Hari, but he constantly meditates upon you. You reside on the couch of the bejeweled, expansive chest of Sri Vishnu, as inseparable as lightning within a gathering of clouds. Does this not mean that Sri Vishnu is your Vahana? Mother, if you separate from Sri Vishnu, performing puja to him will become impossible. It is evident that even if a person is honest, amiable, generous, peaceful and virtuous, if he does not have you residing in his heart, he is abandoned by all, including brother and friend. O Devi of immeasurable power and majesty, please tell me, these gods like Brahma and others who are eternally adoring and paying homage to you, were they never women? I am convinced, O Devi, that they were once women and you turned them into men. O Mother, you have all the powers to make women into men and men into women. Please be merciful to me and make me into a man. The Devi was pleased and changed Ila into a man. Now Sudyumna prayed, O Devi, in my heart, I know that you are neither male nor female, neither formless nor having a form. Whoever you are, whatever you are, I worship you incessantly and forever. Mother, it is my earnest desire that I may be worthy to worship you always. Suji said, saying this, Sudyumna surrendered himself and took refuge at the lotus feet of the Devi. She granted him heaven in her divine abode, a place coveted even by the gods, from where there is no return. On the demise of Sudyumna, Pururava started ruling the kingdom. He was brilliant, upright, and virtuous, and was always concerned about the well-being of his subjects. His kingdom, Pratishtan, was a happy and pleasant place. He was very tolerant and had knowledge of all dharmas. He was already blessed with godliness. Under his rule, Vedic prayers, charity, and gifts to holy men, discipline and transparency of administration were maintained. All castes and communities performed their respective rites at their ashrams in complete freedom. He himself performed manifold yajñas and distributed presents and donations. Seeing his image of royalty and grandeur and hearing of his valor and virtues, Urvashi became attracted to him. She desired to make him her husband. The Apsara Urvashi had a curse upon her by Sri Brahma, which caused her to take birth as a mortal. She approached Pururava with a proposal for marriage but put two conditions. Firstly, he should take care of the two rams that she had and that she would eat only ghee every day. Also, she should never lay eyes on his unclad body. If any of these conditions were broken, she would immediately leave him. Pururava agreed and she lived with him, waiting for her release from the curse. The king was totally infatuated with Urvashi and thoughts of her began to rule his head and heart. It became impossible for him to be without her company even for a minute. Many years passed. Sri Indra began to miss Urvashi in Devlok. He called the Gandharvas and asked them to make efforts to get Urvashi back. He suggested they steal the rams from Pururava's place. He told them to use any means but to definitely bring Urvashi back as his court was dull without her. So, the Gandharvas and the demigods descended on the palace and stole the rams. But as they were ascending back to heaven, the rams began to bleat. Urvashi loved these rams like children and when she heard them, she exclaimed to the king, "You promised to protect these rams who are as beloved as children to me. By putting my trust in you, I have been destroyed. You are just lying with your eyes closed like an impotent being." The king lost his senses and jumped out of bed and ran unclothed behind the thieves. It was pitch dark, but the Gandharvas caused a flash of lightning. Urvashi's eyes beheld the unclad king and immediately she disappeared. The Gandharvas abandoned the rams and left. The king managed to catch the rams and return to the palace tired and weary. When he did not find Urvashi, he realized that she had gone forever. He kept wandering from place to place. His appearance became like that of a madman and he roamed the earth looking for her. At last, he saw her in Kurukshetra and begged her to return as he could not exist without her. Urvashi said, "O king, you are very foolish. You have lost your sense of wisdom. Return to your palace. It is futile to be so dejected and sad." In spite of this, he continued to sink into the mire of attachment and suffered pangs of separation. Suji said, "This is the story of Urvashi and Pururavas."